one thing I know, Bob, is we're decimating a bunch of those little banks in those little towns, so there won't be so many anymore. But when you remind us of the importance of politics here, I it's undoubtedly true now, always has been, maybe more now than usual, but I found myself sitting in a... I found myself a week or two ago in the office of my, when you say louder, it's appropriate, audiologist. I have audiologist-type problems. And I just had a whole bunch of magazines sitting in a waiting room, and the one sitting at the top was an issue of Time magazine shortly after Dodd-Frank bill was passed. And the big black letters on this thing with dollars spilling out of the Capitol building was, "We have the best law that money can buy," which I'm afraid has some resemblance to the truth. But, you know, Bob started off by saying he was going to embroider on Ben. I don't want to embroider on Ben. I want to destroy him. All this business about do we know whether the financial system is operating effectively and a net benefit to the economy. Where you been, Ben? The financial system has brought us down. Not only ex-crisis or in the midst of crisis, but why are we in this crisis? In the first place, for a decade, this country has been spending more than it's been producing. It's gotten an unbalanced, totally unbalanced allocation of resources in the economy, with consumption rising well above previous levels, capped by a great home building boom, all financed by this great financial system we have and made everybody so happy. And of course it all broke down when the crisis broke, and we end up with the biggest economic problem and the highest sustained unemployment than we've had in years and years and years. And I really don't think we have to sit around figuring out for 3 years whether the financial system net had some responsibility for this. I have offered a prize some time ago. Jim fortunately pointed out, you know, it was quite clear that he didn't count me in the ranks of the economists. And I'm probably making this clear at this point, but I have offered a challenge to the ranks of economists to the first PhD thesis that can produce in a convincing way that the modern financing system has brought us higher productivity, higher growth in the GNP, a more balanced economy than we've had back in those primitive days before this highly engineered, highly sophisticated banking system came about. I think we can all agree with Bob Solo that a certain amount of debt is essential to a growing economy. But maybe we can all agree that a certain amount of debt can be overdone. And when the amount of debt went from more or less 150% of the GDP, back when I was looking at these figures 20, 25 years ago, to 300% of the GDP, that maybe we were overdoing it in terms of leveraging and financial practices that were not totally sustainable. So I agree, the function of this system is certainly to get an efficient allocation of capital, and I think it's failed kind of miserably in recent years for a variety of reasons. Partly a kind of philosophical reason that people thought things couldn't go wrong, everything was self-equilibrating, all these fancy new techniques we had for transferring risk or reducing, he never quite said reducing risk, but somehow it got distributed in a way that was almost unfeeling, and it would be easily absorbed if things went wrong. Well, that didn't prove to be a very accurate forecast of what would happen when we had things go wrong. It got really highly concentrated in a few very big institutions that gave us considerable trouble. So I don't think I have to go on forever suggesting that the financial system needs some reform. It needs some humility. And it became the great fault of human life, I think, in so many different ways is hubris. And the financial system was making a lot of money. The economy was doing very well, seemingly in stability, but in the last 10 years, the productivity and growth has been no greater than in the 1960s. Remember those primitive days when we didn't have credit default swaps and we didn't have subprime mortgages and 20% down seemed to be rational practice and commercial banks dominated the financial system? How primitive could you be? But we had pretty good growth, very little inflation. It's kind of a nice economy. And people accuse me of wanting to go back to some characteristics of that time when I was young. And I confess, I say I'm guilty. Mm-hmm. I want to go back to the future. And I think there's some lessons to be learned in that connection. I do think we have shaken the faith that the economy and financial institutions, financial markets will be self-sustained, reach an equilibrium without any outside guidance, and that we ought to leave it alone so it can reach that equilibrium. Now, I don't want to overdo it, but I think there are a lot of things that have to be done to produce change in the financial system to remove some of the excesses that disappeared. Ben mentioned the amount, everybody knows the amount of pay, profits, and pay of people in the financial system. All of this analysis is a little difficult, but you know, you ask, what have we gotten? That's the question he's asked. What have we gotten from all this earnings and cost in the financial system? And I don't rely entirely, I don't know how they get all these figures, but you know, a standard measure of the contribution of different sectors to the economy, what's the value added? And people kind of add up incomes and profits and salaries and stuff, and they say that must be value added. And if you look at the nominal figure for the finance industry, and there are various measures now of how narrow you define it, but roughly in something like a 10 or 12 year period before, I think the last figures actually are in 2007, financial value added is reportedly up about 75%, or almost double. It looks good. It goes up from 5% of GDP to 10%, or 6% to 12%, or something like that. And that surprised me a little bit, because I wasn't sure I saw the results in other ways in the economy. But then somebody showed me the real, that's the nominal number. And they said, well, here's the real number, the real contribution of the financial system to the economy. And it says in that same 12-year period or so, it went up not at all. So somebody in the bowels of the Commerce Department, and I don't know how they do this, Ben, but somebody in the bowels of the Commerce Department was making adjustments, price adjustments in the financial system that took away all the seeming value added. Now, I would not take that as the last word here, but it seems to coincide with the sense that you have that with what is a really tremendous movement of profits and income to the financial sector, and match it up against the trend growth in the economy over the same period, you don't see much effect in terms of profitability or progress or productivity for the whole economy. So I say this only to justify what I think is kind of almost taken for granted now, that we need a reasonably thoroughgoing reform of the financial system. A lot of it's tied around the leverage question that Bob mentioned, and that kind of core issue, which we haven't quite discussed here, of too big to fail and what's the result in terms of financial behavior from an impression that the winners will win and the losers will be bailed out. which I think does skew incentives in a difficult way, and in a way that it's, there's no easy answer to that question. And Dodd-Frank bill, and I'm not presenting this as anything like a finished reform in the financial system, it's not, but it does try to come to grips with some of the problems, and particularly the too big to fail problem. Whether it is at all successful in that sense remains to be seen, because you can make some administrative changes and some legal changes, including what they do say, in pretty much unvarnished words, that if a financial institution is on the brink of failure or fails, the government will have the authority, or some government agency will have the authority, to take it over, to meet its immediate obligations, but liquidate the organization. Stockholders are gone, management's gone, depending upon how it looks in the end. Some creditors will be gone. The creditors will be at risk. There it is. In the law of the United States. Now, I don't know how many people are convinced in their gut that that is what will happen if a very large institution in the future is faced with failure. It probably comes in a difficult economic time, almost by definition, and the government will feel a responsibility to deal with it in a way, some way that will not be called abject failure, which is what the law now calls for. So we've attempted by that and other measures to deal with the problem. It'd be an interesting discussion to how successful we've been. My own gut feeling, which gets around to not only too big to fail, but too big to exist argument, that the commercial banking system still has particularly strategic functions in the economy that will necessarily lead to temptations to prevent failure, to rescue it, but we don't need to extend that presumption to non-banks that may be carrying out an interesting function in allocating credit in the economy, but they're not so vital to the day-to-day function that we can't survive without a substantial failure. So that's an important question that underlies a lot of this reform effort, which I don't think permits of any very conclusive answer. If we could solve that problem in 3 years, I'd be right with you, Ben. But I hope we can. So let me, I said enough controversial things.
All right.
I didn't think they were controversial. I thought they were accepted wisdom.